Welcome back, and this is my personal reading session with a friend, and I'm just adding these videos on YouTube. We now come to chapter 3 of part 4 of the code. This is just the code, and we'll do the regulations later. We're now starting with chapter 3, and maybe we'll do chapter 3, chapter 4, and chapter 5 of this code. And if the video time permits, we can even finish. Yeah, we'll do chapter 3, 4, and 5, which deal with insolvency professional agencies, insolvency professionals, and information utilities, as covered in this chapter, in this part in the code. So that's chapter 3, chapter 4, and chapter 5. Insolvency professional agencies. Now, what's an IPA? It's the agency that actually holds the IPs. So, currently we have three IPAs. One is the Institute of the Chartered Accountants. The other is the Institute of the Company Secretaries. And the third is the Institute of the Cost Accountants. All these are Section 8 companies which have been created for the purpose of this profession. And the Institute, the CA Institute's company is called IIIP of ICAI, which is the Indian Institute of Insolvency Professionals of ICAI. So 199, no person can function as an insolvency professional agency without a valid certificate of registration. It's the same as otherwise provided in the code. No person shall carry on the business of an IPA under this code and enroll IPs as its members except in accordance with and under a certificate of registration issued by the board. This basically goes to say that to be an IPA, you have to be, you know, sort of approved by the board. Second, 200. What are the principles governing the registration of an IPA? So who can be an IPA? Only a Section 8 company that wants to function for the profession of insolvency and bankruptcy in India can be an IPA. So I can't want to do something else and be an IPA. So the board shall have regard to the following principles while registering the IPAs under this code. To promote the professional development and regulation of IPs. To promote the services of competent IPs to cater to the needs of debtors, creditors, and such other persons as may be prescribed. To promote good professional and ethical conduct amongst the IPs. To protect the interests of the debtors, creditors, and such other persons as may be prescribed. To promote the growth of IPAs for the effective resolution of insolvency and bankruptcy processes under this code. Section 201 deals with the registration of an IPA. Now, there is a regulation for this itself. There is a regulation for IPAs. There are two regulations actually, which we'll talk about later. Every application for registration shall be made to the board. So, for an IPA to get registered, it has to get registered with the board in such form and containing such particulars as may be prescribed. Much later, you will see that this form in the regulation is called as Form A. Provided that every application received by the board will be acknowledged within 7 days of its receipt. That's what is specified in the code. But elsewhere in the regulation, it talks about the approval period, about a 45-day timeline, about a 60-day timeline, about a 14-day timeline. So there are lots of sub-timelines within an overall period. On receipt of the application, the board may, on being satisfied that all the terms and conditions are met, grant a certificate of registration, and this will be done in something called as Form B. Provided that no order rejecting. So here, does the board have to approve everybody who wants to be an IPA? No, the board can reject. So when the board rejects, they have to give the applicant a reasonable opportunity of being heard. And every order so made shall be communicated to the applicant within a period of 15 days. So that's what I told you, there's a 15-day timeline. The board may issue a certificate of registration to the applicant in such form and such manner as may be prescribed. It will renew the certificate within such time. Normally, these registrations are valid for a period of 5 years. And incidentally, the fee here is 10 lakhs. And the board may, by order, suspend, cancel the certificate of registration on any of the following grounds. that the IPA has obtained its registration by a false statement. It fails to comply with the board, with the regulations made by the board or the bylaws, or a contravention of the act. So what are the three circumstances where a certificate of registration can be revoked or cancelled? One is it doesn't comply with the act. Two, it doesn't comply with the rules, regulations, bylaws that have been made. Three, it has obtained the registration by providing a false statement or a misrepresentation. Again here, before such suspension or cancellation is proposed to be done, the IPA or the applicant shall be given an opportunity of being heard. No order, please mark this, no order can be made or passed by any member except a whole time member of the board. So presence of a whole time member is a must. Then we have the appeal to NCLAT. So here, any person aggrieved by the order of the board may prefer an application to NCLAT. Please mark this again. Could be important from an exam perspective. Both these questions. Now, I'm not saying the remaining are not important, but these could be your trick questions. Incidentally, I've said this before in my other videos, wherever there is a provisio or an explanation in the act, those are the exceptions to a normally accepted practice. Those could be important. We then go to the next part, which is the governing board of an IPA. So, what does this act say? Section 203. The board may, for the purpose of ensuring that every insolvency professional agency takes into account the objectives sought to be achieved, it can make regulations to specify the setting up of a governing board of an IPA, the minimum number of independent members to be on the governing board of an IPA, and the number of IPs being its members who shall be on the governing board. So basically they say that you will have to come up with a set of regulations, okay, to specify the creation and the constitution of a governing board. And there's nothing major about it. The governing board of an IPA is like the board of directors of any other company. That's all. So there are regulations which prescribe the governing board, who can be the chairman, what is the composition of independent to non-independent members, what is the composition of insolvency professionals being directors on the board to the non-insolvency professionals. So all this we will discuss later. Suffice to say that every IPA needs to have a governing board. Then, okay, we spoke about an IPA, registering an IPA, renewing the registration of an IPA, functions of an IPA, revocation, cancellation, governing board. But let's just go to section 204, which is, why do I need an IPA? What are the functions that an IPA is going to do? An IPA shall perform the following functions, namely, grant membership to its members, lay down standards, monitor performance, safeguard the rights, privileges and interests of IPs who are its members, suspend or cancel the membership of the IPs who are its members, redress grievances of consumers against IPs. So if somebody has a problem with an IP and he has to refer it to the IPA. Notwithstanding that, there are certain circumstances where a reference can be made by the adjudicating authority also to the board. Publish information about its functions, list of members, etc. IPAs, agencies to make bylaws. So section 205 of the code also says that the governing board has to make bylaws. Subject to the provisions of this code and any rules or regulations made thereunder, and after obtaining the approval of the board, every IPA shall make bylaws consistent with the model bylaws specified by the board under subsection 2 of section 196. So this is the power that gives, this is the power of the IBBI to make model bylaws for IPAs, which shall be adopted by the IPAs. So as far as IPAs are concerned, you have a specific regulation that says governing board and model bylaws regulation, which we will come to later. With this, it's a 10 minute closure almost. We come to the end of chapter 3. In the beginning of the video, I told you we'll cover chapter 3, chapter 4 and chapter 5. But I thought it's better to take a little more time. So this is a video only on chapter 3 of part 4. which deals with IPAs or Insolvency Professional Agencies and covered sections 199, 200, 201, 202, 203, 204, 205. Thank you.